Hello and welcome back from Cannes Special Championships. I am Lydia Humber.
And I'm Philip Schultz, and we are happy to bring you round 10. And we are heading into a great match here.
Yeah, we have the current world champion Robin Schultz versus the vice champion of the Oceania International Championships, Stefan Ivanov. Could you have wished for a better match to start the day?
No, I don't think we could. These two players have shown that they have amazing skill. And yeah, we're basically heading right into the game as their players are ready. And they will start the round. Will start playing as soon as they are finished setting up, which is in a few seconds only. And yeah, we will see a very popular matchup being Zapdos versus Malamar. So it's not a matchup that people don't know, but I think in this caliber there's something to learn for all of us. And Robin will be going first, both opening the Jirachi, which is of course great. So both having the optimal opener here. And yeah, Robin going right away for the super strong ability from Jirachi.
Yeah, of course, that's what you want to do. That's what you're wishing for. You want to get into the game as soon as possible.
To talk a little bit about the matchup, it's actually more intricate than some people might guess, because like this Zapdos Jirachi deck on paper looks so straightforward, right? You open Jirachi, you put on Zapdos, put on an energy, and you start attacking, and basically you attack all the game. But that's just the surface of it, because there's so much decision making you have to do to ensure that you get a knockout every turn. And especially this matchup can make it really hard, because Stefan will be using the Giratina we've seen so much of yesterday. And we can actually see one of them in the prizes, but he plays multiple, so he will have access to his Giratina, and one is basically enough, because as we all know, it always returns.
Yeah, always coming back, that bad boy.
Yeah, and the thing is, Robin's Pokemon only have 110 HP, Robin's main attack has Zapdos, and Stefan hits for 130 and has 130 HP, so it seems, also Robin only hits for 80, so it seems that Stefan would be favored here just because of the bulkiness of his Pokemon, right? But you have to consider that Robin's deck is simply so fast, like it will almost always take the first prize, and then it's basically Robin trying to never miss a beat, and Stefan trying to put on the pressure with Giratinas, get with constant knockouts, and just tank a few hits. And yeah,
we see Robin setting
up. He already got a Zapdos with an energy. He's setting up the Blitzel for the Zipstriker. The Zipstriker, of course, is a great ability. It's like, it's an additional engine. Like, the engine of the deck is Jirachi, but the Zipstriker with its spread ability can always help.
Yeah, it helps you especially to draw into more cards if you have nothing to work with. Jirachi can give you that one missing piece, but sometimes you just need stuff to throw away for an Ultra Ball, for example. Or you might not need a trainer card, you might need energies. So, yeah.
Exactly, it's just a great optional thing to have. And yeah, Stefan, we've seen this explosive turn once from Malamar players all day yesterday, and here we see Stefan opening with a Jirachi and Inkai, having the Lily right away. And an interesting choice from him is to put down the Ultra Necrozma, which is a very solid play in my opinion. Like it can look weird, right?
Why does it look weird to you?
I mean, this matchup is all about trading non-GX, not giving up easy prizes, right? So putting down a big GX feels like, oh, but what if Robin Guzma's around it, puts down a Shrine of Punishment, next turn it's a bit damaged, and it can be already like a few electro powers, and it's an easy knockout, and Robin can pull ahead even further in the prize trade.
Yeah.
But you have to consider that Stefan is playing an Acerola, and the Ultra Necrozma has 190 HP. So what Stefan is doing, he's saying that, okay, it's the early game, right? Your deck is not thinned out, you only have so many damage modifiers. You won't get in one shot right away. You need like three electro power and a choice band.
But I mean, yesterday we've learned electro powers, they never come alone.
Certainly. But yeah, what Stefan is trying to do is that he's using the Ultra Necrozma as early as possible, because then there's also no threat of the Tapu Koko GX. So he's trying to avoid to get this big kill from Robin.
Yeah.
And this big one shot, and on the same time, he has this Acerola option. So, in the early, if you can trade with the Ultra Necrozma versus non-GX, so you take a one-shot for a two-shot, that's still fine, right? And maybe he can even hit the Acerola, so if Robin doesn't have a Guzma, has to has to hit the active Ultra Necrozma, then Stefan can get the Acerola, and suddenly Robin's not ahead anymore but behind.
Aha! So and he could like swing around at the pace.
Exactly. Also, it would leave him with no GX Pokemon on the board. So then he would be in the price advantage and would only go to go on to stream those Giratinas every turn to take up prize after prize and win the prize race this way, with Robin hardly having anything to stop him.
Yeah, but I mean, let's see how this game is going to turn out. Speaking of both players, I think Robin entered day two as second seed, Stefan as third or fourth seed.
I think they were fourth. Third and fourth.
Yeah, so they are in a very good position in this tournament. For all of you watching, Alessandro went into the tournament with seed one, Gustavo Wada seed two. So a lot of players we had on stream yesterday managed to make their way into day two. So if you've watched the stream yesterday, there are quite some familiar faces going to come back to the stream. Actually, Charizard made it, so I'm very hyped about casting a Charizard match again.
Yeah, and here we see Stefan already setting up quite well. He has three Inkai, he has this Ultra Necrozma for energy, ready to make big plays next turn, and he even has a Giratina already on the bench, using this amazing ability to damage, interestingly, the Zapdos. Like, I would usually expect him to maybe damage the Striker, because the Zapdos will probably be knocked out by Giratina's attack, and putting damage on the Striker might set it up for a later knockout with Ultra Necrozma's GX attack.
Yep, and we see Robin playing a Cynthia, getting some fresh new hands, cards in his hand, which is certainly always good.
Yeah, and Robin's certainly looking for a switching card here, right? He just wants a knockout on the Jirachi, that's basically all he needs. So an escape board or a switch would be perfect for him. Escape board not quite so, because Stefan could send up the Giratina, and yeah, Robin doesn't want to see the Giratina and be active. And yeah, so Robin's looking at his cards. He's using the Jirachi again. And he's using Jirachi's ability again. And yeah, looking for some switching options, as I mentioned. And yeah, basically, here we see also the Tapu Koko Prism Star, an amazing card in both Zapdos Jirachi decks. It's setting up Robin's ward for later. It's quite tanky, there's no drawback in putting it down. Stefan might choose to Guzma it, take a knockout on it, to take this threat out of the board, but then he's leaving energy on the board, so like, it's pointless, right? Tapu Koko is meant to bring energy into play, and like, to get rid of it, he would have to leave energy in play on Robin's side. So.
Yeah, and he would also not knock out an attacker.
Yes.
For basically just removing an energy, so
yeah,
it's not really the best option.
Yeah, right. So like, putting the Tapu Koko down, it's it's just great to have, and there's like no drawback to it. And so here, Robin's still not switching card yet, but it might be that he has it in his hand. And
the game cam crashed.
Yeah, we're very sorry for that. I hope they just keep playing and don't get distracted by this. One of us is running there to make sure of this.
Connor, our hero, is saving it.
Yeah. I hope they just keep playing and don't get distracted by this. And yeah, unfortunately, our setup is a bit suboptimal today. It got kicked overnight, so we had to redo the setup quite quickly this morning. And yeah, we are very sorry for that.
But anyways, I mean, you can see the full bench, so we should be fine.
Yeah, so the angle is still surprisingly fine, right? And it was just a split second of chaos. And yeah, those two players, they are used to play under pressure. They have been in these tournaments over and over again. They both played in the finals of the biggest and most prestigious tournaments out there. They don't get distracted
but
that easily.
They're also used to playing on our low budget stream. So yeah, it's Stefan's turn again. He's playing an Erika. He's getting some Malamas into play. He has two Malamas ready, one Inkay still waiting to get evolved. So he's in quite good board position. Do you have any idea how many energies he has in his discard pile?
Not exactly. However, there's a... Now I see the 10 damage from the gear IT now. Yeah, that's... I don't know how I could overlook this. But yeah, Zapdos of course has 110 HP, so with the 10 damage from Giratina it's only at 100, so Ultra Necrozma only needs to discard one energy to take a knockout on it. So
yeah,
of course,
true.
This allowed Stefan to not need any free retreat Pokemon. He could instead just send up the Ultra Necrozma right away, and he will be able to take a knockout with a single energy, which he already got from his Viridian Forest.
Yeah, that's huge. I mean, Robin probably picked up on that.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, those Zapdos are not meant to survive a turn. They are one energy attacker.
Prize card only.
Yes, they are meant to take a prize and they are meant to give up a prize. But all Robin's deck is about is taking this prize advantage and then never letting it go again. And yeah, he's in prime position to do this. Because he already has the Jirachi, he already has the Striker, and we see some kinda risky-ish place from Stefan, because he's accelerating energies onto his Giratina, leaving his board with three energy in total, and Robin having this Tapu Koko Prism Star already, which means, as we all know, that Robin might take this knockout with Tapu Koko GX.
But I mean, that wouldn't be too bad, because the prize trade would still be two prices, because then the Tapu Koko GX would be in the active position.
Yes, the thing is that Stefan would have to use another Ultra Necrozma to do that. So
is he even playing a second Ultra Necrozma?
Yeah, of course. He's playing these Ultra Necrozma Malama decks. They are focused on big one-shots, they are focused on this Ultra Necrozma. They have multiple of those for sure, they have Rescue Stretcher to get them back. So yeah, there's plenty of access to them.
True.
And yeah, if Stefan would not be able to take a knockout on that Tapu Koko, if Robin opts to use it, that would just be terrible for him. But as we see Robin with a Shrine, he probably doesn't want to use the GX to take the knockout.
I mean, it would be quite greedy.
I mean,
there's a lot to ask for, and
I mean, all he really needs is a Tapu Koko, because he has Lightning Energies in his discard pile. He has the Viridian Forest to search out an energy, and yeah, he basically would just activate Tapu Koko Prism, activate the ability of Tapu Koko GX, send it into the active, and then he needs one damage modifier, because it's already 150 and there's 10 damage on the Ultra Necrozma.
Oh, and we see Robin getting his Buzzwole out of the deck, probably getting ready for his Sledgehammer turn.
And yeah, Sledgehammer is of course always a powerful resource.
But that also means that he's not going for the Ultra Necrozma. Now.
Yeah, he will probably go for a Guzma knockout on this Inkay, which is always a great option. And oh, we see the Beast Energy from Robin. This is of course great. If he has a Guzma now, and yeah, he still has Sprint. Oh yeah, there's the Guzma. That's amazing. So this, after Stefan takes the knockout here, Robin will be able to deal 150 damage with his Buzzwole. So meaning that a choice spent will be enough to take a knockout on this Ultra Necrozma. Alternatively, if Stefan does not manage to replace the stadium, it will be enough as well.
Yeah, and that also leaves Stefan only with two Malama. There's no Inkay left. Ideally, you want three Malama on your board to always be ready to power any attacker up you have in your deck.
Yes, certainly. So, also, yeah. Having only two Malama, his board is weakened. Robin will try to pick up those Malamas later on just to take, because they are easy to knock out compared to the other Pokemon Stefan has.
Yeah.
So he will probably goose by at least one of those and take a knockout on it.
So we see Stefan playing a Nest Ball.
Yeah, he's probably just going for an Inkay.
Yeah, but I mean,
There's not really any other. It might be a Jirachi as well. Because
be.
Robin didn't go for the app, so his bench is already full here. Of course, there's the Tapu Koko Prism, which he can easily replace by something else, but yeah, it doesn't seem like he's really interested in putting down apps. So he's just going for the prize straight, using his bench for his attackers, being confident that he can take a prize every turn. And yeah, so Stefan is allowed to use his engine, so he can search out a Jirachi, attach an escape
pod to
it.
He's going for Tapu Koko.
Tapu Koko is of course a great card as well. It has this free retreat naturally without even having the need for an escape board.
Yeah.
And yeah, it has a very useful attack as well. We've seen Nico yesterday using this attack against the Zapdos deck and putting him in a great position where he could take multiple knockouts because his opponent underestimated this Tapu Koko and allowed it to attack multiple times.
I mean, this damage really adds up over time.
Yes.
Flying Flip every turn, getting 20 damage on every Pokemon your opponent has in play. That's quite a lot if you attack two or three or maybe four times.
Exactly, 20 damage doesn't sound like a lot, but there's
it's on
six,
the whole field.
Yeah, there's six Pokemon on the board, so that's already 120, and the Zapdos has weakness as well. And yeah, here we see Stefan not wanting to activate the Sledgehammer from Robin, just opting to go for the Tapu Koko instead. Thinking that, I don't want this Buzzwole to have a Sledgehammer. I don't want it to take a big knockout on my Ultra Necrozma. That would probably be the game. Robin would be down to two prizes, and there's nothing that could stop him. So I just want to go for a spread strategy. I can use this to make a comeback with my Ultra Necrozma's GX attack.
I mean, it makes sense. Robin is basically telling Stefan, hey, if you're taking one more prize, you're getting punished for that.
Yes.
So Stefan is like, okay, I can't attack one Pokemon with a lot of damage, so I just attack all of your Pokemon with a tiny bit of damage.
Exactly. Also, this allowed him to play Cynthia, maybe looking for this Guzma to pick up the knockout on the Buzzwool next turn and get rid of this threat and the beast energy on it.
Yeah.
Now Robin, this Tapu Koko, of course, seems like an easy knockout as well. And what he's definitely looking for is a Shrine of Punishment. Stefan's already used his second Viridian Forest, so he probably only has one at maximum left.
Yeah,
well,
looking
actually,
at his deck list,
actually he plays a full fog. So I don't think I've seen this before, just because this Viridian Forest is so popular, it's in so many decks. So many people are opting to play a lower count.
I mean,
it makes sense
because once it's activated, once it's in the game,
certain.
You can't get rid of yours in the deck, so it makes your deck quite clunky.
Yeah, but Stefan is thinking, those Shrine of Punishments are just too strong of a stadium. I need to get rid of them. I need to replace them as soon as possible every time. I want to always have access to my energy. And after all, the Viridian Forest has this great effect where you discard one card and then search out an energy. So it might sound like a drawback, but it can actually be very useful to get rid of useless cards so you don't draw them later on. Or to get some psychic energies
in your discard pile.
Exactly. It's just discarding effects are just so good in this format, especially since Stefan's playing a lot of Lilia as well. He wants to get those psychic energies in the discard pile. He has many cards that are meant for his setups that he doesn't need later on, that he wants to get rid of. So this Viridian Fall is just such a great addition.
And we see an escape rope. The Giratina getting in the active position and Robin.
Yeah.
Stella wishing.
An escape rope is probably not what Robin wanted to see here. With the switch, he would have needed only a single electro power to take a knockout on this Tapu Koko. Also the spread, while seemingly
there's the
not
Guzma.
And yeah, this Guzma. I'm wondering what he will opt to target down. Will it be a Malamar? Will it be the Ultra Necrozma? Or might it even be the Tapu Koko again?
I think it might be the Tapu Koko. So he forces Stefan to actually take a prize next turn.
I think all of these are legitimate options.
So what would be the advantage of targeting down the Malamar?
Yeah, Malamar, of course, right now doesn't do much because Stefan has lots of attackers on the board already. But getting rid of your opponent's energy acceleration is always huge.
Of course.
But on the other side, this Tapu Koko was just too threatening because it allows Stefan to perhaps make a comeback using his Ultra Necrozma's GX attack. This spread is something you should never underestimate. It can be really huge.
Sure.
And yeah, so Robin taking the knockout with the Buzzwool, abusing this Tapu Koko's fighting weakness and using the damage boost he got from the beast energy to hit for 120 damage. And there we see the Acer roll of Stefan.
That's huge.
Getting rid of his Ultra Necrozma he put down turn one. He didn't get to use it much, Robin didn't attack it, he just opted to take easy prizes right away, instead.
I mean, that's what his deck is designed to do.
Yes.
It's not designed to KO this GX cards, it's designed to take one prize after another.
Exactly, while slowly chipping away at the GX and softening it up for a big knockout later on. And Stefan realizing that this Ultronic Crossmo became a big liability in the meantime.
Yeah.
Robin already being ahead two prizes in the prize race, with this Ultronic Crossmo on the board being an easy finish for like something that Robin could use to easily close out this game.
Yeah, he don't want to hang out on your band.
He needed to get rid of it.
And we see Giratina in the active position again. Stefan actually attaching energy to his Jirachi, which is interesting.
Yeah, he just wants to make sure that Robin, even if he puts down an Absol, he will be able to retreat this Jirachi thanks to Escape Pod and the energy.
And I mean, he's in a position where he has enough energy in his discard pile to dedicate this one energy to his Jirachi. He does not really need Melomir's abilities for anything else this turn, so it's just a safe play, having the energy here, just in case. It's no drawback for him, so yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And yeah, now we see Robin searching out one Electro Power with a Jirachi. If he gets another one, he can take the knockout with the Zapdos. He has used a lot of his Guzmas already. I think it's like three. So
I think so, yes.
Yeah, so he probably wants to take a knockout on this Giratina here. On the other side, he's still not quite in range for an Ultronic Crossmas attack. The Zapstriker has 110 or 120 HP, I believe.
I think it's 110.
It's certainly out of range for the time being. Oh, and here we see an escape rope from Robin again. This time it's coming in much stronger than last turn, where it was just a card he used and then used Guzma anyway.
Yeah.
So.
And Stefan decides to give Robin a Melomir.
Oh, this Melomir knockout, because Robin has an Electro Power in his hand already, can be huge, because if Stefan does not manage to get out another Melomir and doesn't charge up any attacker, Robin can use his Tapu Koko GX next turn without any threat of retaliation from Stefan. Because with only one Melomir on his board, what can he do? He can't power up an Ultronic Crossmo for a one-shot. He can't even power up a Giratina. So, yeah, this Melomir knockout can be really huge. But Stefan valuing the Jirachi more than he does with Melomir, thinking that he needs access to his important cards. He needs stuff like Rescue Stretcher, maybe
he needs some
Nest
comeback
Ball,
options.
Ultra Ball. Yeah, he just needs control about his deck, so he wants to have this Jirachi ability.
So, do you think Stefan is at a point where he's still able to actually win this game?
Yeah, I mean, you can always win, especially with Melomir. This GX attack being a great comeback option, but Robin smartly using the damaged Zapdos, wanting to get rid of it so that, because it already has 50 damage, so this and the Jirachi would be an easy pickup by my Ultronic Crossmo's GX attack.
Yeah.
And yeah, Robin doesn't want that to happen. So sending up with Zapdos, hoping that it gets knocked out, is of course great for him. What Stefan probably wants is to not take a knockout on it. He would very much like to soften up another Pokemon of Robin, but fortunately Robin has played this really well. He hasn't taken a single knockout on a Giratina, so Stefan only managed to use the ability of it once.
Yeah.
And this ability really is important in this matchup, because after a while it starts adding up and those Pokemon...
Yeah, it gets you into this range where you can actually get a one-hit KO very easily.
Exactly, those Pokemon and those Pokemon like Nihilego and Zipstriker tend to get softened up by it. In combination with Tapu Koko, they make up fodder for a multiple prize knockout.
Yeah.
But yeah, what's Stefan? He might go for another, if he has Rescue Stretcher Guzma, it would
with
be...
There's the Guzma.
Yeah, but he doesn't have a Rescue Stretcher, it seems like.
Sure.
Otherwise, he could have gone for a Tapu Koko spread again, and Guzma something like the Zapdos. But yeah, Stefan's just taking a knockout here on with Substriker, thinking, okay, this is looking bad. Robin is pretty far ahead already. What I want is to disrupt his engine.
Yep.
So he's taking out with Substriker, making sure that Robin sees as little cards as possible so that he whiffs at some point. And yeah, he's probably hoping for a whiff from Robin, so.
But I mean, Robin, can't blame him.
But Robin, still having Guzma left, still having only used a single Electro power, has all the resources he needs to take this knockout. Also, he still has the Tapu Koko GX.
True, yeah.
And he will be able to use Nihilego's attack to copy Giratina's Shadow Impact next turn. So, he basically has everything he needs. A Guzma here, a double Electro power, even a Tapu Koko. Tapu Koko GX, all of those would be enough for Robin to take the knockout on this Giratina. And when he's down to one prize, only needing a Guzma next turn to close out the game.
Yeah, it's always that one single Guzma you need in the end.
Yeah, on the other side, he can use the Guzma now and then go for Tapu Koko GX next turn.
He could go for the Malamar.
Yeah, Malamar is certainly a good option.
Or the Jirachi.
Yeah. I think he would prefer Inkay or Jirachi, just because those are an easy knockout without an Electro power.
Yeah.
And now being almost, I think he should be out of Guzma's, or almost out, so it's either his third or fourth, but he's used a lot of those already. And yeah, he's going for the Jirachi, he's going for the easy knockout, so that he has all his Electro powers, Electro powers left for a big knockout next turn, so that he can make sure that Stefan doesn't have anything that survives an attack from Tapu Koko GX.
And what's Stefan going to do now? I mean, what's the plan?
There's really not much he can do. He can take two prizes with Ultra Necrozma's GX attack, but that's not enough. He still has three left.
And he needs the Ultra Necrozma first.
Yeah. The Ultra Necrozma shouldn't be too hard to get. His deck plays a huge amount of item cards with such amount of Pokemon. He plays 4 Mysterious Treasure, he plays multiple Ultra Ball, he plays multiple Nest Ball, so. And he has a Malamar already, so there's the Ultra Necrozma.
Ultra Necrozma, first part of the puzzle.
He's probably.
Metal Energy.
Yeah, he wants to go for the Ultra Necrozma here just because it's the Pokemon with the most HP. Taking a knockout on the Giratina would be extremely easy for Robin.
Yeah, and I mean, obviously he does not want to leave the Inkay in the active position.
Oh yeah, that one is for sure. But like, the Giratina, it would be knocked out by Tapu Koko GX just by attacking normally.
Oh, we see Tapu Lele Guzma.
Interesting choice. I'm not sure what he wants to target. It's probably.
I mean, maybe it's his only switching option.
It might be the Nihilego. It might be that he's just thinning his deck. Because now the Tapu Lele doesn't matter anymore, anyways. Because Robin is out of. Because if Robin has a Guzma, there's easier targets than this Tapu Lele on the board.
That's true.
But
yes.
The problem for Stefan is that he promoted his Inkay. He did not promote the Giratina. Which is a questionable play for sure, because it leaves a lot of energy left in play. If he promoted the Giratina, he could retreat it. Okay, he's actually doing it now. Because he wants these energies to be gone.
Yeah.
So that Robin can't use the GX attack of Tapu Koko, because it does 50 damage for every energy on Stefan's board, right?
Yeah.
And here we see Stefan using the GX attack, taking two prizes. Getting rid of some energies, and now it's on Robin.
There's the switch.
There's a Guzma, and that's the game. Robin's last Guzma for his last prize. But to be honest, Robin had all the options in the world to take this knockout. He still had the Tapu Koko GX. Still had so many Electro powers. He still had his last Guzma.
I mean, we saw him being up in pace during the whole game. He made a great job. He dominated this first match.
Robin has shown why his deck is so strong. He has so many options at all this point. He has this Buzzsaw threat. He has the Nihilego. He's threatening the Tapu Koko GX at all times.
He definitely is.
And He just took the first prize.
A lot of pressure on Stefan. Exactly. And Stefan just couldn't catch up.
He had with Giraci, he had with Striker to get him all he needed. He just took the first prize, and then he showed, my dad can do this. I can take a prize on anything, every turn. This is just normal business for me.
Being Stefan, is there anything you would have learned out of this first match?
Well, honestly,
was it just bad luck, or was there something he approached maybe in the wrong way?
I think Stefan did most. I can't isolate anything that really gave Stefan the loss. He did everything right. He tried to go for the Ultra Necrozma early on to have this Acer Roller option. He tried to set up a GX attack with Tapu Koko. He did all he could, but Robin simply always had the answer. So this is really showing that the matchup really can be in Zapdos' advantage quite easily, just because of how fast the deck is and how efficient it is at never giving up the lead anymore. And yeah, Stefan probably wants to execute the same strategy. Now he's going first, of course, so there's the difference. Robin being ahead one turn last game made it possible for him to set up properly, to have everything he needed. It certainly made it easier for him because he got out with Substriker, he got the Giraci opening. So he had time and he had the engine to make it happen.
Yeah, he definitely had.
This game, Stefan is going first, so with a Giratina opening, which is pretty good for him because this forces Robin to have a Guzma or an escape rope to take a knockout, but Stefan might put down another Giratina to just make sure that Robin can't use escape rope for an easy knockout.
Yeah, and you want that Giratina to go into your discard pile early, so you can start spreading damage.
Yeah, the big thing about the Giratina here is that it's huge, 130 HP. So oftentimes we see those Jirachi or Inkai active and they are just easy knockouts, right?
Yeah, they're cute and little.
Robin just would need an escape board or a switch or any switching card and an energy to take the prize lead. And yeah,
Robin wants a switching card now anyways.
Yes, exactly.
This Abzol is supposed to sit on the bench and wait there and do its job.
Exactly.
It's not supposed to attack.
Just the switching card, however, doesn't do much for Robin because then he will deal 80 damage to the Giratina, and this doesn't really do anything for him. He would just sit there, do 80. Stefan would probably get a switch, get a knockout on the Zapdos, and Stefan would then be ahead in the prize trade. So Robin now really needs either an escape rope to get the Giratina out of the active, or if Stefan gets out another Giratina, or an Ultra Necrozma. Ultra Necrozma would still be fine. Robin could attack that. But if he gets another Giratina, Robin would be forced to have a Guzma. Otherwise, he would not be able to go ahead in the prize trade. However, Stefan already being down two switches, if I saw this correctly.
Yep.
He Ultra Bolt one, then played another one. Puts up the Giratina. And yeah. Now, the problem now is that if he draws into he can't even retreat with an escape board. So he would need an escape board and an energy to retreat with Giratina again, send up the Giratina to have a wall in the active.
Uh-huh.
But then he's running the risk that he might get stuck in the active. We've seen this happen even to the Zapdos deck yesterday, where people just had the Giratina active, it was sleeping taking a quick nap, just for a couple of turns. Meanwhile, they didn't manage to draw any switching cards, any Guzma, and just had to pass their turns. And yeah, this might happen to Stefan. Oh, and this is a terrible opening.
Switch.
Stefan does not have anything. His single Tapu Lele is in the prize cards, so he couldn't Ultra Ball for that. He had to go Ultra Ball for the Giratina, but unfortunately it didn't give him any supporter as well.
Poor Stefan, that's definitely not what you want to see.
I think this is the first time that we see the Malamar deck bricking, because usually they just go first, get this Lily, they have all of those mysterious treasure on Ultra Ball to guarantee Lele into Lily or all those natural Lilies, they have all these ball cards.
And we see Stefan playing in Erica.
Yeah.
This is also not really something you want to see now.
Exactly. Erica shows why she's such a two-edged sword. It's such a great supporter. People said that Erica, which used to be Steven's advice earlier, is one of the best, is like the best draw card ever printed. just because it allows you to draw like 6 cards without having to like reshuffle your hand back or discard it. So you could build up a huge hand of up to 10 cards. And people used to say it was the best draw card ever. But the drawback is, in the early turns, it doesn't do much. If you have it on the first turn, your opponent will probably just have one Pokemon.
Yeah, I mean, all the old school players out there, they probably know this drawback from cards like Colress.
Yeah, exactly.
It was the same
Colress is another one like this. On the first turn, you hate to see those supporters.
Yeah.
Erica.
Colress, at least, you can do something about it too. Colress said,
yes, exactly.
For each Pokemon in play, yours and your opponent's.
On the bench.
Yeah. Oh, sure.
Yes.
Okay.
It's it only counts for bench. So that makes it even harder, because otherwise it would always be a minimum of 2.
Yeah.
Or like, usually like 3-4. But yeah, because it's limited to the bench, it was oftentimes just for 1. I've seen people use Colress for 1 or 0, which is basically bad, because like, it's such a desperate move, because you're putting so many cards back into the deck that you're even unlikely to top deck anything.
Yeah.
And it was always such a sad situation to see that people had nothing but Colress. And yeah, here we see the same thing basically happening to Stefan. Having nothing but Erica, using this Erica for 2 cards. Robin taking the lead, and Stefan putting down the Giratinas, just hoping that, please don't draw stuff. Please just attack the Giratina and give me some time so I can draw into my Cynthia, I can draw into my Lily, and I can start going.
Yeah, and I mean, Robin is of course noticing that Stefan has nothing to work with.
Yes.
And now's the time to put some more pressure on Stefan. He even managed to get ahead in prices. And
and
there
Robin
is another Guzma.
So this not only allows him to go even further ahead, this also disrupts Stefan's spot severely.
Yeah.
He's left with 2 Giratina. He didn't even get energy attachments. He won't be able to get multiple Malamar into play. He doesn't have any energy yet, so he won't attack anytime soon. The Viridian Forest, great of course, being able to get some energies onto his Pokemon and thinning the deck at the same time and reducing the amount of cards in hand at the same time, so
and
Lily top deck becomes even stronger.
This might even be Stefan's first deck search?
No, he played Ultra Ball in his first turn. So he played the Ultra Ball, probably wanting to pick up Tapu Lele, but yeah, the Tapu Lele is sitting there in his prize cards and he only plays a single one because Jirachi is so strong, but the Jirachi didn't do him any good.
Yeah.
And it's back to Robin.
You see the Choice Band getting attached to Zapdos? You don't really need the Choice Band, but you also don't need it in your deck,
yeah,
so
exactly.
You just attach it to get rid of it, have a few of better options to actually draw from your top
exactly.
of, top
also
of
this,
the deck.
Also, Zapdos is in no danger of getting knocked out soon, so he can afford it. Also, like, Robin is up 2 prizes. He doesn't have to go super aggressive here. He can afford to just maybe even do 10 damage to the Giratina. It really doesn't matter much. He just uses the Cynthia to build up his hand again, to draw some cards. Maybe he can get... Oh, the Blitzer is actually in his prizes, so he won't be able to get the Substriker out this game.
And it's also one of the last
Jirachi,
prizes
so
he's going to draw.
He has everything he needs. Also... He's 2 prizes ahead, right? So he just wants to save those Guzmas to get some easy knockouts later. And he's doing 10 damage here, which looks nice for Stefan, but doesn't really matter. And he doesn't draw anything. He can't use the Viridian anymore.
Oh, that's so sad.
Because Robin replaced it and...
Yeah, I mean, it's maybe interesting to note that, speaking of OCIC last week, Stefan changed his whole deck from the Zapdos deck to the Malamar deck to maybe have something more consistent. But what about Robin? Do you know if Robin made any changes to his list at all?
Well, Robin told me before the tournament that he doesn't know what to play, but he said, oh, my Oceania deck, it was so good. Like, it had all the options it needed. It could always have multiple threats. You could always, if you played correctly, if you sequenced correctly, it felt like you always had whatever you needed. You could always do something, you could win basically every game, and there were no bad matchups other than Mill. But
oh, and down goes the first Giratina. Stefan actually managed to get energy on board, and Robin immediately
And
Stefan, crush Stefan's dreams.
Bringing back the Giratina, having it just sit there to stall some time. Meanwhile, the time's running out. Only 11 minutes left, Robin being 3 prizes up. This is really hopeless for Stefan. And here, as I was saying, Robin said this deck was just so consistent, so versatile, that it didn't really need change. But I'm seeing that he did change something, which is a very minor thing. He just, in Oceania, he used to play 3 escape board and 1 escape rope. But okay, seeing how much people value this Absol, he probably decided that it's not worth it and he cut one
escape board
for an escape rope, exactly. Okay. So having those other switching cards that don't really care about Absol, he's valuing those above the escape board.
So at least he adapted a tiny little bit to the meta.
Yeah, it's a minor engine change, but the deck in general is pretty much the same as it used to be.
Yeah, I mean, for people maybe not being too much into the game or the meta or the new cards in general, what you want to do with this deck is having Jirachi in the active position to use its ability Stellar Wish. But Stellar Wish has the drawback of Jirachi being asleep. So if you have an escape board attached to it, you can retreat it without it having retreat costs, and even though Jirachi being asleep. But what people do is they play the Absol.
Which we can see on Robin's bench.
Yeah, it has the ability that all basic Pokemon...
Yes, the active base... If your opponent's active Pokemon is a basic, its retreat cost is increased by 1.
So if you have Jirachi sleeping in the active position, even though it has an escape board attached to it as a tool, you can't retreat it for free, you still need 1 energy. So changing the escape board for the escape rope just adapts to the fact that he might have faced a lot of people playing Absol.
And yeah, he certainly did. Everyone did play it. And Stefan drawing his first Malama. So at least he has something. But yeah, he can't really capitalize on it. Meanwhile, Robin gave Stefan a little bit of time, sending this Jirachi active, saying that, yeah, I want to see more cards. He doesn't seem to... No, he's getting a Lilio. I was just about to say that he seemed to not have any supporter in his hand, because he basically pretty much used the Faulkner for not much he needs. But yeah, of course, getting this escape board on the Jirachi now, from that he searched last turn, having an energy for the Zapdos ready. And he's getting rid of 2 Shrine of Punishment. Doesn't really need those, right? I mean, here's other Electroparas, here's Tapu Koko GX.
And there's not really anything the Shrine could punish.
Exactly. Yeah, Robin was...
Oh, Connor just tried to kill me with his luck. I should stop doing puns.
But Execute is such an excellent deck that you can just make jokes about it as much as you want. I will never get tired of them.
Oh, thank you, Philip.
And yeah, here we see Robin. He's like, he's even charging up his Absol. It has a fairly decent attack. It deals 30 damage plus 30 for every colorless, for every energy in your opponent's retreat cost.
So I actually never read Absol's attack.
It can be relevant because there's a funny interaction if its ability increasing the opponent's attack cost and thereby increasing the damage output of the attack, which is surprisingly relevant because usually it would deal 90 damage versus the Zapdos, but
yeah,
because the ability increases the retreat cost of the Zapdos to 3, it will knock out the Zapdos.
Oh!
So this is relevant in the Zapdos mirror when one plays rainbow energies, because both players usually put down the Absol to disrupt the others, so then the rainbow energy player can use Nihilego's attack to copy Absol's attack, and
really follow you, I'm sorry.
The Nihilego copies an attack of the opponent,
yes,
right? So in the mirror match, you can copy Absol's attack with Nihilego to knock out a Zapdos.
Ah, okay, now I understand.
And yeah, some people tend to overlook this because Zapdos retreat costs 2, so it would usually be 90 damage. But because the ability of Absol actually increases the retreat cost of your opponent's defending Pokemon, it is a knockout on Zapdos.
So now we see Absol.
Yeah.
And it's actually hitting Giratina for weakness.
Yes, exactly. So Yeah, it doesn't even need the weakness actually, because the retreat cost of the Giratina is 4 because of Absol's ability, so it attacks for 150 anyways. But it will be 300 damage on the Giratina if Robin opts to attack with it.
But instead, I thought we will see Robin getting some extra style points here. Very unfortunate.
But instead, Robin is targeting down the Jirachi, realizing that it's still not looking good for Stefan at all. And so he just targets down what Stefan needs for his consistency.
Robin is very, very mean to Stefan. He's just being like, hey, you still have that Jirachi that could help you. Oh, I'm gonna take it away from you.
Yeah, Stefan's like, oh, let me put on this Jirachi next turn. Or maybe the turn after I get to use it, maybe I'll see my first supporter. And Robin's like, nope,
no,
not gonna
no,
happen.
No. I'm not happy with
At
that.
At least not with this Jirachi. And he's also putting down the Buzz Roll with the Beast Energy. Being able to use Sledgehammer if Stefan takes a knockout here. Dealing exactly 130 because of Beast Energy. And so it would be 150 minus 20 because of the resistance.
Yeah, Robin is playing that game extremely well.
Yeah,
he's not being greedy at all. It's something that some players like fall into if they get ahead too fast. They stop playing consistent. They start doing these greedy plays, just going for the attackers or going for the GXs if they are in play.
Exactly. Robin's realizing there's no pressure on him. He's up ahead. He's up already. He doesn't need to finish this game, so he doesn't go for like super greedy aggressive plays to finish it as quickly as possible. He can just approach this methodically. He can set up his threats. He has the price advantage. He knows if I have a price advantage, I'm usually gonna win anyways. But if you're dead drawing as well, well, even better for me. It allows me to play even safer, even more conservatively.
What you gonna do?
Nothing. Oh, sure, let me just take a knockout on this and this. Oh, and let's take out your Malamas. Oh, your Jirachis, they look kind of dangerous to me.
Oh, you touched the energies from your hand. That's cute. They're gone now.
That's cute. I'll allow you to take 2 prizes and then meet my friend Basvo. And yeah. So it's basically looking for... Stefan's expression basically shows how well this game's going for him. He's just sitting there and waiting, being like, okay, Robin, you got this, but let's just keep playing for a bit.
We should show some more respect for Stefan.
Yeah,
he's still there.
He's doing what he can, of course, but with the cards he got, there's not much room for optimal play there anyways.
Really. And then we see the Sledgehammer.
Robin going down to his last prize, Stefan not having any attacker to
knock
out this
basketball,
and that's game for Robin. Robin Schulz takes the series 2-0 over Stefan Ivanov, advancing to 8-1-1 and being in prime position to make it into the top 8.
Yeah, actually we had a conversation during breakfast, you and I, and you told me like, oh, a Schulz being 7-1-1 after day one, so from my experience, he should go 3-0-2 today and then make it into top 8.
At first seat, yes. I think it happened every time so far.
So, no pressure on your brother. Maybe we can get him for a short little interview. We'll see how the rest of the round did. We don't really want to delay the tournament.
I think actually the time's almost up. Also, it's time in the round already. So unfortunately, we won't have any interview with him. I'm pretty sure we will see him again. And maybe later. maybe that's too early to call. But I'm.
You might be biased.
I'm optimistic to see him again in top 8. So we might feature him again and maybe we'll get an interview next time. I hope you guys enjoyed it.
Oh, we just do an interview with you and pretend you were Robin.
I mean, yeah, sure. we can do this another time.
See you guys later.
Yeah.